an honor and a blessing to be present amongst all of you. And definitely interfaith dialogue is something that we need to continue and embrace so that we build better understanding, goodness, and mercy. And I'm honored to meet Rabbi Aaron and all of you. And I appreciate the great work that Azim is doing with IDI. And I know they've done tremendous work in interfaith as well with different cultures, communities, and religions. So with these few words of introduction, I just want to get into the topic at hand, identity and assimilation. Now, not too long ago, I was contacted by a Muslim community of Nunavut. And the question was, what time do we pray? And the reason for this is, as some of you know, Muslims pray five times a day, and they are based on sun movements. And up there in the north, the sun can prolong for 6 months, and you get night for 6 months, darkness for 6 months. So there's an array of opinions, and there's an array of Islamic verdicts in theology in regards to how we calculate prayer when there's sunlight throughout the day, throughout the night, etc. So this is one simple example of how in modern time we are challenged as Muslim clerics or theologians how to make Islam relevant to the communities that we live in, to the circumstance and the modern situations that we face on a daily basis. And this is definitely a concern of the Muslims. And we see that there's mass migration of Muslims across the world. If we look at Canada, it's the largest minority. Muslims are the largest minority according to the census here. So there are concerns, there are questions, and recently many Muslim scholars have developed what we call the fiqh of minorities, which means the jurisprudence living in a non-Muslim country, how to practice Islam. And many of these rulings are totally contrary to the rulings that you would hear in a typical Muslim community. For example, it is impermissible technically in a Muslim community to offer the same prayer twice in the same congregation. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So one service has taken place in the particular mosque. Now it would be disallowed, it would be impermissible to repeat that very same prayer or that service in that very same mosque, because the idea is want everyone in one particular congregation. And the main prayer for us is on the Friday. And in North America, you see many mosques who have service one after another. If you go to a Muslim country, you will never find a Juma service, a Friday service, a sermon and a prayer on a Friday being repeated in the very same mosque multiple times. So it is deemed allowed and permissible in this part of the world. Obviously, with the limitations that we have, everyone doesn't have off or holiday on Friday. You know, there are not as many mosques. Where do we pray? When it particularly refers to this prayer that must be held in congregation. So this is the type of situations that have modified some of the theology, some of the fiqh, the jurisprudence, and it's based on the different communities that the Muslims are traveling towards, are residing and becoming citizens of different parts of the world, where Islam may not be the predominant religion of the time. So there are cultures that are being blended in, there are influences. And, you know, some years ago, 10, 20 years ago, maybe even 30 years ago, many of the Muslim migrants, they were simply concerned about making ends meet, and they would practice the religion. What's happening now is that the youth have now become part of the society where they're striving to be in the mainstream communities with high-ranking positions in all fields, in all perspectives in the society, and they don't want to feel left out. So again, this is enhancing the cultural collaborations, the working together, being influenced, and the Muslim who's conscious would want to make Islam relevant to their particular situations and their circumstances on a daily basis. So what we've seen is that some of the youth, through these dilemmas, they have developed their identities. They have come closer to religion, and they're consulting with Muslim experts. This is my situation, this is my circumstance, how do I apply Islam in this particular situation? I've been invited a number of times, many government agencies, many schools, many hospitals, for sensitivity training. And this shows that Islam is being practiced even in the mainstream world, in the communities and the societies that we live in. In the Scarborough Hospital, a whole program on halal foods for Muslim patients was recently developed. Similarly, Bell Canada invited me to do a whole presentation on washing or ablution for Muslims before they pray, because they have a lot of Muslim employees in one of the particular branches of theirs, and there was water all over the place because they're washing themselves for prayer. And they were saying, what's happening here? There's safety hazard, so on and so forth. And they were getting all these different opinions from their employees. They finally invited me and I did a full-fledged presentation, and they made some modifications in regards to how their washrooms are set up and how they can have a comfortable place to make the ablution and also pray. So again, these are signs that Islam is being practiced in the mainstream society, but at the same time, without compromising Canadian values, without compromising the positions that they're involved in, and being full-fledged mainstream in the mainstream society with these positions and their relevant situations. So, what are some of the dangers? What are some of the threats that may be posed in these circumstances and situations? Well, many traditions, they are fearful that we will lose the value or the true teachings of Islam when we start to tweak and we start to modify. And there's this sort of danger that will we lose the essence of the text? Will we lose the essence of the source teachings? We find in some situations where we are very far from the original text and what is being portrayed. And in other situations, we find that there is still some essence of that left. So there are some elders, there are some traditional scholars who tend to fear that it might reach a point where it's absolutely modified. One of the verses that we constantly recite in prayer is that we want to be sirat al-mustaqim, on the straight path, without being those who are misguided, or without being amongst those who alter or modify, and that is definitely a danger. Another thing is that when it comes to these circumstances and situations, there is definitely a concern that when there are, for example, just as I came in and speaking to Rabbi, and we're talking about interfaith marriages, and this has been an increase when Muslim Canadians are integrating, they're being part of the society, they're embracing, and then the concern is about definitely the children, what will be their faith, and different circumstances and situations that come about in those circumstances and situations as well. So definitely, assimilation, I don't like to generally use the word assimilation, because what it actually means is to forget about your values and you become part of another culture or another community or another religion. What I like to tend to use is the word integration, where we are part of our communities, we are part of the mainstream, we are considered Canadians, but at the same time we are all free to practice the religion the way we feel that it would be relevant to our circumstance and our situation. So I agree with the rabbi, what he said earlier, that despite these cultures coming together, and in some situations it may seem as a clash, but it's definitely an opportunity to engage and to work together and to find ways to consider oneself following their religion, and at the same time being part of the mainstream society and being great Canadians that bring about goodness, harmony, and peace amongst one and all. So with these words, I conclude. I look forward to the interactive session. Thank you very much.